Hello dear students, I welcome all of you to the online lecture series of St. Andrew's Institute of Technology and Management, Gurugram. My name is Ankita and I am teaching as an assistant professor in Department of Bachelor of Computer Application, and in today's video we are going to study further topics of object-oriented programming using C++, and those topics are overriding member functions, what is late binding and virtual functions. So in our previous video, we studied about early binding, polymorphism, function overloading and operator overloading. So we will move further in this video by defining the runtime polymorphism. First of all, let us recall the definition of polymorphism. It says that we can use same name function to perform different functionalities in our program. So function contains mainly three parts: function declaration, function definition and function calling. So if we have same name functions in our class or program, then at the time of function calling, how compiler is going to match the function calling and function definition? When that thing is decided at the compile time, that is known as compile time polymorphism. And when it is implemented or resolved at the time of execution, that is at the time of running, that is known as runtime polymorphism. So the definition of runtime polymorphism says when the object's method or function is invoked at the runtime instead of the compile time, that is known as runtime polymorphism. It is achieved by the method overriding. Basically, you can also say function overriding, and runtime polymorphism is also known as dynamic binding or late binding. Okay. So in runtime polymorphism, function call is matched with the function definition at the runtime. And in contrast to the compile time or the static polymorphism, compiler deduced the object at runtime and then decides which function call to bind the object. So in a single class, when we have same name functions, that situation is known as a function overloading, that we are doing function overloading. But function overloading should be done with the different number of arguments in the functions. And when we have the case of inheritance, and base class and derived class both are having same name functions, so that becomes the function overriding. Okay, so it is usually implemented in the case of inheritance, and you can say the function overriding is having the redefinition of base class function in the derived class with the same signature and the return type. Remember, function overloading never contains the same signature. It should function overloading should always have different number of arguments, different number of and different type of the parameters. And method overriding can only be done in the derived class, and in this case we say that the function is overridden in the derived class. Function overriding is encountered when we have the inheritance concept in our program, and the function is overridden. Yeah, this point is repeated. I will delete it. So we will understand how function overriding happens with the help of the example. So this is the we will consider different scenarios in the case of inheritance, where we have base class and derived class both, and both the class have same name function. So consider scenario one, how we can call the same name functions from base and the derived class. Here we have one base class, we have one show function, and show function just displays a message, base class function. This derived class we used single inheritance here, and it is also having a show function which is showing again a message. So one point is you can create object, separate object for base as well as separate object of D, and you can call the respective functions using the respective objects. So there will be no problem. Function override, we resolved function overriding by doing so, or by creating the separate objects for separate classes. Okay, so this explanation says this only. So let us consider the scenario two, and virtual functions are always resolved with the help of the pointers only. So now we will consider the case of pointers. because pointers are the best solution to resolve the runtime problems, like if it is dynamic memory allocation or you know, achieving runtime polymorphism, we use pointers only. So in this case, we create base class as well as derived class pointers. So now in this example, we will see how a base class pointer is having the derived class address and how the virtual or how the same name function gets called here. This is the base class, it is having show value function. This is derived class, it is having show value function again with the same name, which is known as overridden function. In main function, we have created base class pointer and a normal derived class object. So with the base class pointer, we have passed address of the derived class object. So when we are calling the same name function, which is in base as well as in derived class, when we are calling this function with the help of the base class pointer, which function it is calling? The base class function. Okay, whenever you will write this statement, so it will always call the base class, because priority is always given to the base class function. First compiler encounters this particular function, so it will always execute this class, even if you have the address of derived class object inside your base class pointer. Okay, so this problem also can be resolved by having the separate pointer of the derived class, like derived class pointer you can also create. For example, star p or something. So if you pass address of its object like this, and if you are calling p arrow operator, then show value, then derived class function gets called, there will be no problem. Okay, so I think you understood my point. If I create derived class pointer and then I pass this object into that, and I call p arrow this show value function, it will execute, there will be no problem. It will execute the version of derived class. Okay, so now we will see what is the difference between function overloading and function overriding. In case of inheritance, the overriding of the function that occurs when one class is inherited from the another. If you have two separate classes, then the scope of the functions become different. So you cannot achieve runtime polymorphism in that case, or a case of function overriding. So if you have separate classes, there is no function overriding. Only in inheritance you can achieve the. So if you have separate classes, in that case it will become overloading, not overriding. And the function signature, overloaded function must differ in the function signature, that is, either number of parameters should be different or type of parameters are different. And in overriding, the function signatures must be same to achieve the function overriding. Scope of the function says that overridden functions are in different scope, whereas the overloaded functions are in the same scope. In a program, you can write as many functions with the same name, that becomes the overloading. And when you have separate classes, the scope are different, so that will become overriding there at that point. Behavior of the function says that overriding is needed when a derived class function has to do some edit or the different job than the base class function. Overloading is used to have some same name functions which behave differently depending upon the parameters passed to them. So behavior of overriding as well as the overloaded functions are different. So next we will move on to the virtual function. So virtual functions are the solution to avoid function overriding. We have seen two scenarios above, and with the help of pointers we have achieved them. We could achieve them to some extent, but the function virtual functions are introduced as the solution for the method overriding, or you can say as the solution to achieve your runtime polymorphism. Okay, so there are some rules that virtual function should contain. For the overridden function, that should be bound dynamically to the function body at the runtime. We make the base class function virtual with the help of keyword virtual, and this virtual function is a function that is overridden in the base, in the derived class. Okay, so only that same name function will be made virtual by which we are passing the function overriding. Okay, virtual function must be members of some class. Virtual functions cannot be a standalone function, they should be a member of a class. Virtual function cannot be static, they can be friend or of the another class, but okay, they can be friend of another class, but they cannot be static. They are accessed through object pointers only, and a virtual function must be defined in the base class even though it is not used. It should be defined at least. If you do not define it, it can behave as the pure virtual function but without the keyword pure. Okay. The prototypes of a virtual function of the base class and all the derived classes must be identical. If two functions with the same name but different prototypes, C++ consider them as the overloaded function. We have seen this point in the previous section also. We cannot have virtual constructor, but we can have virtual destructor. We will see the example also. Now, how virtual function are implemented. See, we have one base class, the show value function is there, and show value function is also in the derived class. We have to write a keyword virtual in front of the function definition of your base class. Then in the main function we will create pointer to the base class and then derived of class object. I have passed reference of I have passed address of derived class object to the base class pointer. Now what I am doing, I am doing the same thing which I did in the very first example. I am trying to call the showVal function, so to which function definition it should go, it will jump to the function which is not having virtual keyword, that is the derived class function. So virtual keyword bypassed this overridden function from the base class. In earlier case, here the base class function was getting called every time. Okay, so the overridden function in the derived class can also be written in the private section. The compiler only checks the type of the object at the compile time and binds the function at the runtime. So it doesn't make any difference even if the function is in public section or the private section. Okay, now if a function is declared virtual in the base class, then it will be virtual in all of the derived classes. So, see, if we create or if we write any virtual function, then there are some important points which works behind, and in the front end, in the program, you may not see the differences between virtual functions and the normal functions, but here are two points we are going to discuss that makes a virtual function and a normal function differ. The virtual function is bound to the function body accurately at the runtime by using the concept of virtual table. Whenever we create any virtual function in our program, then compiler creates a virtual table for it and a hidden pointer known as _vptr. So these two are created when we use any virtual function in our program. Both these concepts are internal implementation. They cannot be directly seen on the program itself. So what virtual table does, the compile time sets up a vtable each for a class having the virtual functions as well as the classes that are derived from the classes having the virtual function. So here for the base class as well as for the derived class, for both the classes vtable will be created by the compiler. The second point, it contains entry that are function pointers to the virtual functions that can be called by the objects of the class, and there is one function pointer entry for each virtual function. So whatever number of virtual functions your class will be having, it will mark one entry for each virtual function. Okay, so and vtable also maintains a function pointer to the virtual functions that can be called by the objects of the class. Now what _vptr does, it is also called as vtable pointer, so it is hidden pointer that the compiler adds to the base class, and vptr points to the vtable of the class. So compiler creates this vtable and vpointer points to the current pointer to which or to whatever virtual function in the base class my pointer is pointing, it points to that particular location. Okay, or all the classes derived from this base class inherits the, this is all automatically inherited. When we inherit any class from the existing class, then it gets automatically inherited. Every object of a class containing the virtual functions internally stores this VPTR and is transparent to the user. Every object of a class that contains virtual function that internally stores its own VPTR. So we can say that with any virtual function, VTable and VPTR are associated, and compiler maintains a separate VTable for each virtual function, and it will maintain virtual VTable for base class virtual function as well as derived class, because derived class is inheriting the virtual functions for that. So this section was the important note for all of you to keep to stay in touch with the virtual pointers as well. These type of points can be asked in any interviews when you go further for the job and all. So we will see one more example. Here we have base class, here we have virtual, a class can have as many virtual functions as a programmer wants. So this is virtual function 1, this is virtual function 2, base class is having. Base class also having one virtual destructor. This is derived class which is having one destructor and one virtual function. Okay. So we are going to see how this program going to behave. We have created one pointer with the help of new operator, and the base class pointer is then assigned to the derived class pointer. Okay, so when I am calling B arrow function 1, then which function call you think that should get called? B pointer is having pointer of derived class. Now which function should it should call? It will call the derived class function. And here when we have function 2, see, base class and derived class both can have virtual functions. So in this case, both are hidden to the compiler. And when I have created pointer of derived class and I'm passing that pointer to base class, then it will call the derived class function. And in the second case, it will call the base class function. Okay. So here is the explanation, what is happening here. We have also derived a class from the base class, and in that class we have overridden only one virtual function. Base class was having two virtual functions, whereas derived class was having one virtual function. Then we call both the virtual functions using the base class pointer. We see that the overridden function is called when it is called, and not the base class function. Overridden function got called because this was the same function in the base class as well as this was the same function as well as in the derived class also. See, okay, so overridden function gets called in the simple manner when we call the function 1 simply. And in the second case, as the function is not overridden, the base class function is called. So if we would have the function 2 here also, then in both the cases derived class function would have been called, but here only function 1 gets overloaded, or you can say overridden, so only function 1 is getting executed. So this example was for your knowledge only. So for exam point of view, you can just go through the content which I will share with the video, and you can prepare for the examination accordingly. So here polymorphism topic ends. Further we will have exception handling and then templates, etc. Besides that, we also have pure virtual functions and abstract classes, which I will be covering in my next video. Thank you so much. Take care.